Ma'am, today and yesterday, 2 days of super brainstorming on mediation at the law faculty too here. What is your message and what is your key takeaway? We have seen scores and scores of sitting Supreme Court judges, district judges, High Court judges, and I assume that, how would you summarize?
I certainly think that mediation is going to be the way of life, hopefully in the near future only. And the fact that so many judges, so many lawyers, so many mediators came together in the university, for me it's a way forward that universities have to take a big role in promoting mediation. So having mediation as a course is certainly a big name, but I think we need to have now mediation centers in the universities also. I also believe that, and I think as the last speaker did mention this, that mediation has to go beyond lawyering itself also. At one level, lawyers and mediators have an opposite role. Lawyers represent one party, and mediator actually has to be a neutral party. And therefore, as a beginning coming from the court system, because initially when mediation started, the judges were the mediators. Then it has moved to the lawyers. Now I think it has to move also to non-lawyers and the ones who are still in the process. Teachers, for example, law teachers are certainly one category of persons, and I think involvement of law faculty in this program will pave the way for mediation centers to open up in universities and in other law schools as well. And I think this has to be promoted not only within the legal system, but at the social level as well. If you see the board says, Vivad hai, if it is there, come to the mediation center. So it is not that when people reach the stage of wanting to file a case that we should start thinking. Even much before the parties have reached a desperation stage where they start thinking of going to the court, it has to start. And it has to become a way of life, whether it's a dispute between a student to student, whether it's a student between a student and teacher, teacher to teacher, workers and the non-teaching staff and teachers or students. So whichever, it's not necessarily have to be a civil dispute. If there is a conflict, there should be addressing that. And I think mediation and counseling, etc., works in a big way to maintain cordial relationships, restore whatever has gone wrong when there is a little dispute also. I certainly believe that.
There are a few critics who say that mediation is the fallback option when the litigation happens, when the people go to court. Mediation is a fallback option because in India, country like India, where we have 3 crore cases pending in all the courts. Do you agree with them or do you dispute them?
I don't agree with this. This is a fallback option. This has to be the primary option, actually. And also, when you look at traditionally, Gram Panchayats doing? The punch system tha. What were they doing? Everybody get together and everybody knows everybody, everybody knows the facts, etc. And disputes were settled right at that level. So mediation in that sense is not that it is foreign to India and it has to be seen as a fallback option when things are not moving in the court. And that, in fact, that has been the objection judges had, that it should not be projected as that because the judicial system is failing, therefore mediation. Mediation has its own ground to be there because it has a different starting point itself. The starting point is that you are reflecting that yes, there are relationships which are strained and you need to deal with that. It's not necessarily my right. It is much more to do that what is my relationship with the other. While in the legal system, it is the rights-based approach. So it's coming from a very different position. And positions lead people to look at law and legal rights, and they're stuck on their positions. Mediation is all about finding out what is your interest. You want a partition, not 50-50. Why do you not want 50-50? What are your interests involved? And that movement does not happen in litigation, because it says, okay, you're two brothers, you are 50-50, entitlement matter over. But if you're in a mediation, and you want to find out what is it that the parties can accept as a just settlement, just resolution?
If I may take this opportunity to put a word, is it common denominator? that you want to talk about, that both the parties are looking for a common denominator in mediation. What I meant is, what is the acceptable norm, acceptable format or acceptable options for both the parties?
No, what I'm saying is more that one is not looking at strictly what are my legal rights. Because when you look at the whole legal arena, we're all talking about rights. Constitution does have a provision called 51A about fundamental duties, which are duties of citizen to citizen. We do not look at that. And once we say that, okay, are we looking at what is expected of me? Not only what I expect from the law, but what is expected of me? Am I doing my duties as well? And in mediation, you can address the whole range of issues involved. What are my duties? What are my responsibilities? What are my rights? While in the litigation system, you will only primarily look at what are my rights, what are the disabilities created by the law. But social conversations does not happen on those lines. Social conversations, there are a lot of emotion, especially in the family matter, there are a lot of emotions involved, relationships involved, growing up together involved, living together in a long-term involved. All that doesn't happen in rights-based approach. And also in commercial matters, which may be a one-off, but in commercial field also now a lot of long-term continuation is required. So I think the parameters for arriving at a consensual agreement are different. They start from a different pedestal and they end up on a different pedestal. So I don't think they're competing value, but there will be a lot of matters, for example, when you require interpretation of law. You can't do mediation. So there are matters which are not suitable for mediation, but majority of them are not. So if you require a definite interpretation of a law, you have to go to court of law. But all other matters which do not require interpretation of law and meaning of the law, you can, if there are interests involved, you to find out what are the interests of the parties. So it's a different approach from my perspective, my understanding.
Do you feel that mediation should be more robust, it should have more teeth in terms of more organized way of mediation? Or do you feel that as and when the two parties agree, or as and when the two parties are brought together and the mediator comes in the picture, and that is the only right way? Or do you feel there is a scope of improvement, plugging in few loopholes or gaps so that it becomes more robust?
I believe robust, yes. But the meaning of robust is not they have to have a teeth. Because the moment you bring teeth, then we are talking about somebody is being given a danda and saying, okay, go and do that. But I think the conversation today which said you make it mandatory but also easy to opt out. That's a good approach to start with, and I like that idea itself. But when I say robust, I mean that people who are doing the mediation, they have to be very sensitive and not biased. Biased in the sense that, do they understand where they are coming from? What are their values? Are they imposing their own values in the manner in which they're dealing with the dispute that they're settling? Many a times when I have dealt with my students in the simulation exercises, or when I watched mediation, etc., I do feel that sufficient attention is still not being paid to the hidden unconscious biases of the mediators. So what happens most of the time is that mediators actually become conciliators. They keep on suggesting this is a better way, this is a better way, and they become judgmental. So I think we need to give more attention to making the mediators more self-aware as to what are their values. Are their own values affecting the manner in which they're dealing with the persons who have come before them? So that will make it much more impartial and much more acceptable to people. Because if you feel that, suppose I'm a party and I go to the mediator and I feel that, oh, he has a certain viewpoint. So he's not kind of not party to me, and he or she is impartial to me and to my husband, for example. But they're not impartial to the patriarchal setup I'm looking at. So if I feel that that person has got a bias of certain kind, then I may not feel that it's the right forum for me too. So I think clarity about mediators' own personality for themselves is important, so that they can decide whether to use that bias or not to use that bias. And we've been saying this for the judges as well. Because when we say judges have to be unbiased, the same has to be true for the mediators also. And bias is not about favoring one party over the other. Bias is also about my own values and
impacting that decision
yes.
making
yeah,
process.
Because my own growing up affects how I think. So I think that certainly needs to be made part of the mediator training.
In last 2 days, what I understand, and you may like to clarify or add value to that, is that mediation is when the mediators are being given orientation or they go to a class or they take some courses. It is value addition rather than there are some bindings into that. What you call about the principles and the non-biased attitude. But do you feel that there is, apart from the course, there should be some more binding on their deliverables?
You know, I learned about mediation way back in 1995. This is what we call as the skills of a mediation and mediator. But it takes a long time. So 40 hours or your 21 days of training is not sufficient for you to become a certified mediator. It's a process where people have to reflect as to what they've been doing in those mediations. And there has to be continuing sessions with them to find out, you know, self-psychoanalysis, for example, that what I have done today and what I have done in the last one year, there has to be, you know, refresher courses in that sense where people can reflect on their experiences and share that how they handled a certain case. And sharing can tell us that whether they had done it right or not, because as a mediator, I would do my best. But whether that best is really the best, somebody else should be able to say. My parties won't be able to say that because they are in any case interested. So I think sharing of experiences at a periodical level with others. And many times I've heard judges say that we had a dilemma about an ethical issue and about a particular evidence and we were not too sure. But they got no mechanism to sort out whether what they did was right or not. So I think those kind of meetings are necessary for people to grow, to understand. And also, I think after just 40 hours of training, to put people in independent mediation should not happen. I think as in the High Court also, when a judge is made, new judge, they're always made to sit on a bench so that they gradually pick up the ropes of the trade. I think the same should happen for mediation also. That the initial years, it takes a long time to understand that what is happening, the dynamics of the group which are happening.
Legal system has evolved over a period of time. Do you think we are at the right time to bring mediation and arbitration into our legal system, or maybe for the benefit of resolving the cases?
No, we are very late in the day. We should have started it decades ago. I've known in Australia, New Zealand, for the last 30 years they've been doing restorative justice for serious offences like rape and murder. We are still not talking about mediation in even petty offences. So we are very, 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 very late. We're only now picking this up. So I don't... And it's kind of modern version of what we've been doing earlier. So certainly we had it in our traditions, then we forgot it. All the legislations and everything came in and litigation became the primary mode of of decision making. So I don't think it's the appropriate time. It's already too late. We also need to look at the reports which are coming on the skills of the trainers. It's not very heartening. And I've heard senior judges talk about it, that the analysis of the skills of trainers, of the mediators, has not produced very satisfactory results. Only 3 or 5 mediators were found to be doing mediation satisfactorily. So I think that's where quality control, it's spreading horizontally, but I think the quality of the mediators has to improve in a big way.
You have hit the nerves.
I'm glad that, you know, this impact studies and this tests are happening to find out whether mediators are really good. So that has to happen more frequently, and I think those who are not found fit have to be trained again and have to be, you know, their services have to be, you know, their skills have to be improved.
As academicians, you, MCPC, do you feel that there is a scope of working together, training?
And also I think the point which was made today, that Bar Council has the duty to ensure the standards of legal education. But that doesn't mean that they prescribe papers. So today, if I want to produce quality mediators, I should have a 3-year program only for mediators or a 1-year program within the LLB program. Universities should have the freedom to decide whether they want to produce more judges, they want to produce more mediators, they want to produce more lawyers. Why LLB should be only to produce lawyers? And also we know that after LLB, anybody who clears the judiciary exam can become a judge. But what are we doing as an institution, as a law institution, as a law law faculty, we only focusing because on the producing lawyers. Well, they have got no intention of becoming lawyers. They want to become a judge. But in my course curricula, the Bar Council gives me 24 compulsory paper, 6 are optional. And in 6 optional courses also, it is not the judicial attitude, judicial aptitude, judicial training, judicial the court management, none of that is part of the optional categories. So I can either burden my students and give them more papers, or just get out and say, I want to produce different kinds of lawyers. I want to have more papers on law and poverty. I want to have more papers on law and society. I want to have more papers on gender justice. I want to have specialization in areas where social justice is involved. So my freedom is only up to 6 papers out of 30, because the Bar Council regulates. So I think when we've been saying that we want to do quality, and 40 hours are not enough, when will you prepare those people? So from the very beginning, and I think in that sense, once the Bar Council control is lessened, whoever is responsible for determining this has to ensure that legal education is the business of law faculties, law universities. And whether if they want, presently we're doing, we are turning out like, you know, we have this, what do you call that as line, production line. Everybody
factory
will
line.
Become, factory lines are there. There's a uniform curricula. Everybody has to follow that curricula, and you produce the similar kind of lawyers everywhere through the country, from thousands of law institutions. Why can't people specialize? That one law school will specialize in another. People, let me decide. I don't want to produce corporate lawyers. I should have the freedom to decide not to produce corporate lawyers. And people who don't want to become corporate lawyers will be attracted to me. But presently, it has become, you know, this compulsory thing for me, it's very bugging. And I think there has to be more freedom given to the legal experts. Presently, today what we're talking about is that maybe law bar council should be part of the curricular revision committee in the university. Presently, the other way around. Two academics are part of the of their committee. I mean, what do the lawyers know about teaching? They may know subject, but teaching is a different ballgame.
download Tarang online radio app from Google Play Store.
You are listening to Tarang Devotional Online Radio.